The first time that I'm interacting with all of you on a forum like this, so I hope everybody gets something out of it. Just to begin with, how many of you would be more comfortable if I spoke in Hindi at least once in a while? How many of you would prefer that? Okay. So the thing is, I have a bad habit of slipping into Hindi once in a while anyway, so I hope that doesn't bother anybody here. So if anything's not making sense, or if I'm speaking too fast or too slow, please just let me know. Also, I should confess that there's a bit of false advertising in the way we announced this session. So I said that I will show you savvy workflows that will help you save your time and make you more productive and so on. But the truth is that with all these staff that I have had a chance to interact with, I have constantly been extremely impressed with the promptness with which they respond to my requests for anything, whether it's information or updation or whatever. And I've been wondering ki aap logon ka secret kya hai. So I figured that if I just call you all in one room, it'll give us an opportunity to discuss ki aap log bhi apna time kaise manage karte ho, and chances are that there'll be an exchange of ideas that'll be you know, useful for all of us. I really mean it. I think I've seen you know, so I'm so if there is a computer somewhere, it makes me curious. So whenever, whether I'm going to academic office or even Sunita ji's office, I'm always trying to peek and see what software are they using, how they're doing things. Stage, of course, you know, we share the same office, and I'm always trying to you know, steal ideas about how does he organize his files and stuff like that. So so I'm hoping that this will be a meaningful forum for all of us to share our ideas for how we do things. And as I said, I'll put on the table a few of the things that I've been trying to do for the last few months in an attempt to sort of streamline some of the work that I have to do, especially as a part of communications, etc. And hopefully some of it is new to some of you, and you can, you know, you will find it useful. And if not, yeah, I mean, as I said, I'm hoping that all of you will also share your tips and tricks and things like that. So this should be fun. It's intended to be super informal and interactive. So if you see a better way of doing something, as I said, something's not clear. So I'm thinking that the talk itself will not be very long, and I'm hoping that we can just open the floor and have discussions. I don't know if there's traditionally coffee at the end, so I don't know, chai or coffee pe charcha hogi nahi, lekin charcha honi chahiye. So okay, so with that sort of disclaimer and so on, let's get started. So one of the things that we have to do as part of maintaining information is जब भी इंस्टीट्यूट में कोई एक्टिविटी होता है, चाहे वो स्टूडेंट्स की एक्टिविटी हो या इंस्टीट्यूट लेवल एक्टिविटी हो, जैसे यू नो, ऑडिटोरियम का इनाग्रेशन हुआ, नामकरण हुआ, जो भी है, और अमल्थिया ब्लिथक्रॉन टाइप चीज़ें होती है, या फिर संजीवनी हेल्थ कैंप होता है, न्यासा की एक्टिविटी है, जो भी है. सो ऑल दीज एक्टिविटीज़, वर्कशॉप्स, शॉर्ट कोर्सेज, कॉन्फ्रेंसेज, ऑल ऑफ दीज थिंग्स दैट हैपन, one of our things is to sort of maintain a running diary of the happenings in the institute, right? So that's the kind of data that we deal with. And so for every event or activity, whatever it is, now I'm sorry, you can hear me more clearly. So okay, so with everything that happens, we need to sort of maintain a record of it. And kabhi kabhi I think Piyush saab hum ek mail bhejte hain ki senate ki meeting hone wali hai, board ki meeting hone wali hai, to what are the highlights of the institute from this date to that date, right? To tab hamari thodi band baj jati hai, and we are like, okay, now if this information is not stored in an organized way, then it becomes a little challenging for us to retrieve it in an efficient way, right? That makes sense. Agar hum you know, अब पता नहीं कितने लोग रिलेट करेंगे, लेकिन इफ़ यू ओपन माय वार्डरोब एट होम, यू डोंट वांट टू सी माय वार्डरोब एट होम. सो कपड़े जो है इधर उधर, यू नो, जब भी कुछ नया आता है, यू नो, इट्स जस्ट इट फाइंड्स अ प्लेस कम्प्लीटली एट रैंडम इन माय रूम. एंड सो इफ़ आई हैव टू पुल आउट समथिंग, एंड यू नो, मुझे मेरा फेवरेट ड्रेस चाहिए कल के एसडीसी सेशन के लिए, देन आई हैव टू गो अराउंड looking for it in a manner that is very unpleasant. So on the other hand, people who are very organized about how they keep their things, and I'm very jealous of such people, they can immediately pull out whatever they want. But फिर मामला ये हो जाता है कि maintenance में थोड़ी परेशानी होती है. So if you maintain a very clean and organized room, you may have noticed that every time a new piece of, you know, you buy a new folder or a new file or, you know, a new pair of jeans, you have to make sure that it's in the correct place. And how many of you are like super organized and like keeping things, like you're very OCD, kuch bhi idhar udhar hua to matlab aapke bachcho daant padti hogi ghar pe, etc. So every time you have to store a new piece of information, thodi mehnat hoti hai, lekin, you know, if somebody asks you for that electricity bill from February 2016, like, you know where it is, and that's your moment of glory in life, because aap itni mehnat isliye kar rahe ho taki, you know, aap dikha sako ki aisa kuch query aata hai kisi ka, so you know exactly where to find it. And that is the advantage of doing that incremental bit of hard work when you're storing information. On the other hand, for the messy people, it's absolutely no work to store things because you simply don't care. Jagah mili to dal do, matlab kya farak padta hai. So maintenance mein koi dikkat nahi hai, lekin agar galti se kuch receipt ya matlab tax returns bhar rahe hain aur kuch clarification ke liye aapko kuch dhoondna pada, to bas matlab halat kharab. So wahan pe maintenance aasan hota hai, lekin kuch dhoondne mein bahut halat kharab hoti hai. So you have to kind of decide which way you want the trade-offs, and I am obviously proposing that most of the times it's probably a good idea ki aap roz thoda thoda mehnat karo, lekin matlab, you know, hopefully at the end first of all looks nice, feels clean, so, you know, there's like, psychologically also it's very relieving because you're not under constant stress about, you know, there's a piece of information that goes missing, how do I find it, and so on and so forth. So with this sort of philosophical background, I'm going to propose that, so the way we used to generate these reports is, I would literally open up the Facebook page of IIT Gandhinagar, okay, and look at all the posts that have happened. So for those who came in a little late, I'm talking about the reports that we often have to generate about what are the important activities that happened in the institute between this date and this date. So aisi queries kafi departments se alag alag context mein aati hai. So it used to be very manual, and to some extent it still is. And also it's very error prone. So I'm like searching my emails. So I do label my emails a little bit. So anything that's a public announcement, anything that's not an email that's personally sent to me gets labeled as mass email or announcements or something like this. So, you know, if somebody is asking for a list of talks that happened in a particular department, then I'm you know, employing all my powers of Gmail searching, and I'm like, from this, any email that came after this date, before that date, it has the word talk or seminar or colloquium, and it has the name of this discipline. Or wahan pe bhi pange hote hai, because not everybody sends out, you know, these announcements in a uniform format. Koi department ka naam nahi likhenge, koi, you know, talk colloquium nahi hoga, we have a session tomorrow. So I've discovered a lot of things in this sort of haphazard journey. And now what we are trying to do is that every time a new piece of information comes in, we try to nab it right then and there, clean it up, sanitize it, and put it in a place where we can find it. Okay, so that's kind of the motivation. And of course, something like Google Sheets would be very appropriate for storing information of this kind. Google supports a lot of nice searching and filtering and so on. So how many of you actually deal with data on a day-to-day basis, whether it's student records or whatever else, any kind of data, any significant kind of data? Aapke paas bhi hota hai, mujhe pata hai. Yes, so, okay. And how many of you use a tool like Google Spreadsheets or anything on Google Drive? Okay, cool, very nice. So, all right, so hopefully this, what we are trying to do here will be somewhat interesting. So I should credit Khushbu, she's standing at the back, the girl in the blue shirt. She's been working on fixing up some of this information. So for instance, this is a list of short courses. So this looks a lot like Google Spreadsheets, except that it's not. It's a tool called Airtable. I'll come to why I have started preferring this a little bit over Google Sheets like a couple of reasons. There's still scenarios where Google Sheets would be more useful, but you know, this is something that we've come to like. Okay, so it's a lot like Google Sheets in the sense that, so by the way, even if you don't use spreadsheets or data in your day-to-day work life, you might find that it's useful for even storing all kinds of personal information. So if you enjoy reading a lot of books, oh my God, if you have kids at home and you have to help them manage their school stuff or whatever, spreadsheets, you know, and basically using tools like Airtable can be useful for various reasons. So I'm going to request you to not get bored and bear with me for a while. But basically the main idea in Airtable is that you have rows and columns as usual, but they support what is called views. So you can basically slice and dice your data in different ways. And again, we're going to come back and talk about in what ways this can often be useful. For instance, there's a calendar view which takes the same data that you have in the table, but it displays it to you in a calendar based on a date field that you give it. Okay, so this can sometimes be useful, especially for, so we have a table for talks, for instance. We have a table for short courses. So this is, because this is short courses, it's a little sparse, but if you look at the talks table in the calendar view, you just see, like, you know, for every day, it's very visually appealing to see what are the talks that happened on that day. Right, and I'm going to give you more examples of views and things like this in a while. Also, every view, you can just create another grid view with some saved filters or some saved grouping settings. So one nice thing about Airtable is that it lets you group by fields. So I should back up a bit and tell you that in Airtable, these columns of data that you have, right? You can designate certain columns to be what are called single select or multiple select fields, which means that let me just see if there's a nicer example. Let's go back to talks. So here, for instance, we have a column called discipline. And as you can see, it's a single select field with these options, right? So now if I enter, okay, so it's a whole bunch of things. Now if I have to enter a new, that's my talk here. So basically what I can do is when I'm entering this information, I can just select one of these fields, right? And so that makes it easier. So it's not that somebody has written computer science, somebody writes CSE, somebody, so for all those people who are OCD in this room and who get really annoyed when there's this kind of inconsistency in data, these kind of little features help you sort of keep things fairly clean. So here, for instance, I can say group by discipline. And what that does is it batches up all the records by discipline. So I can see all the physics talks together, I can see all the chemistry talks together and things like this. And the other thing, of course, is filtering. So we have something called the public display view. And that always, so this is a new view that we have created. So is this clear? So there's your main database, which has all the information, okay? So that's like a big dump. But the views let you bring in new perspectives on your data, okay? So I can save a view saying this is a brief view where I only want to see the name of the talk and the discipline. I don't want to see anything else. So I can create that view. And how do I create that view? I basically go here and I say, add a grid view where I'm just going to hide all the other fields. Okay, maybe I want to keep the speaker name and the discipline, but I don't care about any of this other stuff. So I'll tell you why we have so many fields in just a moment. But okay, so I can, excuse me. Okay. All right, so I can call this the summary view where, you know, this is a clean sort of a view where I only see the information that I want. You could hide a different set of columns depending on what you want, and you can group it in a different way and so on and so forth. In the public display view, what we have is we have three filters by which the records are filtered out, and the filters sort of say things like the date of the talk is on or after today. What that means is that the talk is not scheduled in the past, right? And it also says that the date is on or before 1 week from now, which means that it's not scheduled too much into the future. Okay, does that make sense? I'm very bad at these sorts of things, but okay. So basically, the date is before 1 week from now means that the talk is scheduled to happen sometime today or after today, but not after 1 week, right? So it's scheduled not in the past and not too far out into the future. Okay, and I have a checkbox field, which is just, you may have used forms where you see checkboxes. This checkbox field is called public display. So is this suitable for putting on a display board? So some of you may have seen that we have a Chotu Sir TV in block 7, which is now not working, but it used to be working at some point. So on that board, we used to try and show all the talks that are happening. It was supposed to be an electronic notice board, and the information on that board was being pulled from this place. So without any additional effort, we were able to ensure that this board always stays fresh. It's always displaying talks. It's not displaying a talk that has already happened. Okay, it's not so advanced that abhi 6 baje ke baad ye wala talk nahi dikhega, waisa nahi hai. It's just that it will not show any talk that was scheduled for yesterday or before that, right? And that's happening because these views filter out all the junk. Okay, so there's some technicalities involved in how does the TV pull data from the table and display it nicely, but the point is that it can be done, and it can be done quite easily. So the other advantage is that this becomes a centralized source of information for multiple agents to pull data from. So for instance, now the physics discipline people may want to display all the physics talks on a page on their website. So we can give them now a snippet of code. This is a little difficult to do with Google Sheets, because although they allow you to access their data from outside, it's a little complicated. Whereas with Airtable, you can access the data sitting inside an Airtable table quite easily. So I can give the physics folks a link which basically gives them all the talks that have been happening in their discipline. And so I only have to maintain this one table, and I'm not worried about the physics people having data that's inconsistent with the global data and so on and so forth. So I'm guessing that there are many situations where one department needs information from another department, and what happens is that both of you maintain copies of the data. And some of you, I'm sure, are using shared documents on Google Drive and so on. But if you don't do that, there should be redundancy for the purposes of backup. But if you have redundancies in working copies of data, then you have a lot of issues with inconsistency. Kyunki aapke paas ek version hai, mere paas ek version hai, I'll make some changes or I'll make some corrections. Wo aapke version mein reflect nahi honge, ya fir aapne kuch add kiya, mujhe nahi pata chala. So that creates a lot of issues. And I have often encountered this situation where, multiple websites, for instance, maintain their own version of the same data, and then there are naturally inconsistencies because different people are handling the same piece of data. So this is one sort of thing where this is useful. So as I said, these filters are very powerful. You can set up filters with all kinds of rules and cut your data in different ways. Now there are other views which are also interesting, and we'll come to them in just a while. So my motivation for starting this section was to say that we often have to generate these reports. So I do have a view called reports, where what I do is that the date of this event is on or after a certain date and on or before a certain date, because that's exactly the kind of inquiry I get. I get this inquiry that how many things happened between these two dates. So that gives me a filtered list of records, which I can directly print from here. But as I said, since Airtable data is very accessible from outside the system, if you know just a little bit about how to write programs, you can pull this data and create like a really nice PDF or a Word document out of it. It's not difficult at all. And I don't want to get into like the programming details now, because I don't think that's suitable for everyone. But if you have a situation where you think this will be useful, please feel free to let me know and we can talk more. The other nice thing about Airtable, which is probably not possible as far as I know with Google Sheets, is this concept of linking records. So, okay, as you can see here, this is our main view where things are organized by year and month. So this is a group view. But this is the working view where I see all the records. So you'll see that the name of the speakers here is actually, well, displayed in a slightly different way. That's because these are actually records pulled from another table. So we have another table where we just store information about people. Okay, people have come and given talks. So we store their names, we store their affiliations, we store the address of their website or their LinkedIn profile and things like this. Now, I don't want to have like five columns here just about the speaker. That just makes my table go really long. So I don't want that. So what I do is, and there's another issue, which is that, well, these are short courses. So you may have one short course being taught by multiple people. So if this was Google Sheets, you will have speaker one, speaker two, speaker three. And most of the time, speaker two and speaker three would be blank because most short courses are taught by one person and some of them are taught by two or three people. So I don't want to have these blank columns. So here I can just add as many speakers as I want from the people table. So there's another table here, just by the side called the people table, where, as I said, we have their names, their websites, their affiliations, and things like that. And the cool thing about this is that this now starts automatically collecting all the short courses that have been taught by this people. Okay, so it makes sense. It's a two-way linking. So in the short course table, for every short course, I add whoever has taught these short courses. But now it's possible that one person has taught short courses at IIT Gandhinagar three times in three different, maybe somebody comes back every year and teaches this course. So all those courses get listed across the person's name when you go to the people table. So when you go to the people table, you see information about them in one shot, which is kind of useful. So as I said, this is like a compact representation. So whenever you have data where you feel that, so let's take an example of students, students-related databases. So So you may want to have tables related to, so IMS does this to some extent, but you may have a table which is information about all the courses, and you may have a table which is information about all the students. So a student can take multiple courses, and a course is often taken by multiple students. So this sort of a setting gives you a two-way interlinking between these two tables. So again, this is one more way in which this is more powerful than Google Sheets. And like any spreadsheet software, it supports formulas. So you can have, you can highlight, or you can do stuff based on whether one field is set up a certain way or the other way. I have a table where I try to maintain, so I'm the faculty advisor for one batch of students. So I try to maintain the data of who has a backlog in which course, and if somebody has a backlog on a certain course and they've not registered for it the next year, then I tell them, then there's a thing that pops up saying that warn the student that they should be taking this course. Or if they have a backlog in a certain course, so they failed this course and there's another course for which this is a prerequisite, so they go and register for this one, then again another warning pops up which says that they shouldn't be registering for this one because they're not prepared for it. So this helps me just keep my pre-registration database in check. I'm trying to build a data which also gives me timing clashes between the different classes. So whenever the timetable comes out, I try to build this, but I haven't completed it, so it's a little half-baked, so I don't want to get into that. Okay, so are there any questions about the basic setup of Airtable so far, or is it more or less making sense? Oh, so this is just like Google Sheets. It's a web-based software. That's a great question. Thank you. I'm writing it here. It may not be visible, but you can note it down. Perhaps on your way out. So this is just called airtable.com. In fact, maybe in a follow-up email, I'll just circulate links to where you can. So it's free to sign up for an account, and the free account supports up to 1,000 rows in one sort of one database. You can set up as many databases as you want. There's a question there. So it's free to use. The backend is not open source as far as I know. Yeah, so this is what you would call a web-based application. I don't even know what exactly their stack is. I'm guessing they use a lot of JavaScript like most applications do these days. So, but I don't know exactly how it's run. But yeah, it's not, So it's not open source in the sense that you cannot run your local instance of Airtable at IIT Gandhinagar, not as far as I know. I should mention that there are other competitors in this space. All of them have this main idea of, we will show you your data in different ways. So this is one, and the reason I didn't go into these so much is, but it's good to be aware, I guess. So ZenKit is another similar tool. And again, this is their main selling point, that they have different views for the same data. So this is the default view that we've been seeing. This is the table view where your data is organized as a table. But if you have a date column, then you can also organize it in a calendar view. And again, the UI is such that even in Airtable, when you go to the calendar view and you want to change something, you can drag and drop things and it'll work exactly as you expect. The fields will get updated and so on. These guys even support a mind map view. I don't know if any of you use mind maps, but it's just like, I don't know, if you like to doodle and draw rather than make lists and write things down in a linear way, but you like to, you know, really use space on your paper when you're planning things out, then you'll really like mind maps, because this is a way of structuring your information in a, you know, you have a central node which says something like planning my vacation or planning whatever, and then, you know, there'll be things that come out of the central node which say, okay, I have to plan my travel, I have to convince my spouse, I have to apply for chutti, I have to convince my boss, whatever. So your task list gets divided into categories that come out in a radial fashion from a central node. So ZenKit lets you view your data in this fashion as well. It's kind of colorful and spunky and fun. It's nice. So in some instances, so I'll show you an example of a table that was auto-populated from, you know, using a certain script. But in general, so one of the things would be that if everybody sent out talk announcements or short course announcements in a very fixed formatted email, then we could try to automate the process of adding records to their table. But as of now, it's a little manual because people don't use a consistent format to send out these announcements. But the good thing is that once it's, so although adding data is manually done, once it's there, then you can use it to, you know, generate a PDF, you can use it to power a website. Multiple people can have access to this data for different reasons. So I mean, you know, for instance, there is something called the IIT Council website where we are expected to, I think Tej knows more about this than I do, and Meenaji also. So we keep interacting with them every 6 months, and they say that upload information about all the important things that have been happening at your institute and all information related to accounts. And we keep getting reminders from them. And one of the reasons this doesn't get done on time is because we don't have easy access to information. And we keep having to retrieve it from various people, and there isn't a centralized repository where everything is there in a manner that's nice, clean, and consistent. So this is sort of one, so I'm hoping that in the long run, it doesn't necessarily have to be Airtable, although I've grown to like it quite a lot. But if the data was available from one place and different people could benefit from it, and a few, just like a handful of people take charge of keeping the data clean, then I think that would solve a lot of problems. So the Kanban, I don't know how you pronounce this exactly, but this is supposed to be a Japanese origin word. And it's a style of organization where you arrange your data into columns. Typically, people do this for managing their tasks, and I'm going to spend like at least 10 minutes talking about task management a little bit later, so I don't want to digress too much now, but just think of it as every task having a status, a temporal, time-based status. So, you know, abhi aapne kaam shuru kiya hai, kisi ko diya hai, aur aap unka wait kar rahe hain ki wo aapse revert kare, ya fir task khatam ho gaya hai, but you just want to now keep a record that this thing was done. Or a task has just popped up, somebody has just asked you for some information or requested you to do something. So typically a lot of people like to put their tasks in these four categories based on at what state it is. So inbox would be to say that a task has just come in. So this is a brain dump of all the tasks that you're yet to process. Working is the tasks that you're working on right now. Some people like to divide this into today and tomorrow and sort of, you know, much later. So you have a sense of these are the things I want to do today, these are the things I want to do tomorrow, these are the things that will get done at some point, which never happen. Yes. But okay, so that's how they like to divide that. And then you might say that a task is delegated or you're waiting for somebody to finish it. You might say that a task has been finished and I want to archive it. So people who like to make lists of tasks to be done, or a team that likes to make a list of tasks that they collectively have to do, they may want to categorize it like this, in which case it's kind of useful to put these tasks in four columns. So if you were looking at it in the table view, the column would simply say task status, and it would have one of these four or five values. But you put it in the Kanban view, everything that's in the inbox goes in one column, everything that's working goes in another column. So it's the same data, just being viewed in a different way. And then what you can do is, when a task actually changes status, you can sort of drag and drop one task from one column to another column instead of going and updating a table. So this is kind of fluid. Once you start using it, you'll sort of get a hang of why it kind of feels nice and efficient. Similarly, there's another tool called Fieldbook. The reason I don't talk about this much is because it's not really free to use. But it's again, and the reason I'm flashing it right now is to say that this is just another player in the market. And I mean, this combination of spreadsheets and databases is something that's becoming really popular in the business slash corporate sort of community. And I'm starting to get some intuition for why this is so. I think the reason is that the fact that you get the interface of a spreadsheet, which is really easy to use, but you get the power of a database, which is, you know, which allows you to link records from different tables. And then on top of that, you get this really nice interface where you can view your data with different perspectives. All this combined sort of makes this a really attractive way of trying to manage your data. But now I'll just switch to what makes this really interesting is tools like Zapier. So how many of you have heard of either Zapier or IFTTT? Okay, excellent. So at least this is something new. So Zapier and IFTTT are both what you might call Internet of Things. So have you heard of IoT, Internet of Things? Show of hands. Okay, so that's some of you. Okay, great. So Internet of Things, the philosophy is that nowadays almost everything is connected to the internet. At least that's the way I understand it. So you have your smartwatches, you have fitness trackers, your bulbs are smart. Everything is smart these days and is connected to the internet somehow. And once you're connected to the internet, these devices are now empowered to, you know, to be automated and to be controlled in sort of systematic ways if you want them to. So actually IFTTT is a more fun sort of website, so let me load that up first. Zapier is, so these are two different companies. Zapier is like the business version of IFTTT, but IFTTT is great fun. So okay, so abhi Christmas aane wala hai, so unka homepage thoda change ho gaya, but and it's also a little different because I'm logged in, so let me log in. Sorry. Yeah, so IFTTT is short for if this, then that, okay? So what it lets you do is say things like, if something happens, then make something else happen, okay? Right, so you might say something like, if I get an email from my boss, change the color of my bedroom light to red. You can say totally ridiculous things like that, okay? So like just to put yourself on high alert or whatever. So yeah, okay, so this is a more decent one, I suppose. So change the color of my bulb. So of course you need one of these bulbs that connect to the internet. But change the color of my bulb when my Uber arrives, or get my Alexa, which is this, I don't know, Amazon's just launched Alexa in India. It's this really cool thing that talks to you. So if you're really lonely, then you might want to get one. But okay, so, So if you use tools like Evernote and Slack, any of these things, then basically you can connect them to each other. The most common use for me has been things like email. So if I get an email from somebody, so like my credit card companies, for instance, so every month I get these bills from credit card companies. So I have a trigger which says if I get an email from ICICI and the subject line says bill, monthly bill, then take the PDF and put it in my Google Drive in a particular folder, right? So all my bills are organized without my doing anything, right? So, and then this email gets archived, it goes out of the way, and you can even add a task to your task manager which says this bill is due on such and such date, but that I have independently. I don't need IFTTT for that. I have a monthly reminder saying that these bills need to be paid. But what you can do, if you want to be really fancy, is that you can even extract the bill amount from the email and put it in your task manager saying that this is what you owe, this is what you have to pay, something like that. But I don't do that because I just log into the website and it works out fine. And there are other kinds of emails that I get that I know are very systematic. So there will be, you know, there are certain emails with certain attachments that I get on a very routine basis. Maybe even something like salary slips, which you might need when you're filling out your tax returns at the end of the year. You may want to look at all your salary slips from the past year. So all my salary slips, again, get filed in a particular folder. So one thing is that it does take some time to set up initially. And it takes time not because it's complicated, but because the first time you see this, I mean, if you start liking it, it's sort of very exciting. And it opens up this whole new world of possibilities. Like, I can connect anything with anything. This is so cool. And then, like, the first time I saw this a few years ago, like, I set up all kinds of connections and I completely forgot about them. And then, as I went about living my life, I kept seeing files pop up in my folders and emails being sent to myself. And I was like, ye sab kya ho raha hai? So I went back and cleaned up all the connections that I had set up because I was just having fun. And I was just exploring these things that you can do, and suddenly I see, so I don't know if you use Evernote, it's this really nice note-taking application. It lets you take notes, it lets you take normal notes. It's an app that is there on your phone, it's there on most devices, it's very cross-platform, so whether you use Windows or Linux, it doesn't matter. But the nice thing is that it integrates into your browser, so if you see something interesting on the web, you can quickly save it to Evernote and things like that. So one of the things that I have is, like, if I bookmark a website, then take a copy of that web page and put it in Evernote. So I usually bookmark things like articles. So I take the text of that article goes into a folder in Evernote, and I know it's kind of there, even if the website dies out later and stuff like that. So those of you who like your social media, I don't know, how many of you like kind of active on Facebook or Instagram, places like that? Show of hands, like, I'm not ashamed to admit it. So somewhat active on Facebook. So you can totally automate your social media if you want. So you can say that if I post a photograph on Facebook, push it to my Instagram, push it to my Twitter, wherever else. So a lot of people have their IFTTT set up that way. So yeah, you can download the IFTTT app or you can just set it up online, and it sort of lets you connect all these services. As I said, IFTTT is really targeted more at the personal users, so they integrate with a lot of these smart home devices and phones and Uber and things like that. Zapier is more, as I said, business-like. Even their web page is a little more boring compared to IFTTT, but it lets you do some pretty cool stuff. It fully integrates with Google Drive. It integrates with Gmail and so on. So one thing is that to use most of these cool tools, you will have to give some amount of access to your email or whatever else you're using to these third-party application developers. So they need to be able to see your emails to be able to figure out if they should do something with it. So if you have concerns about privacy, then you should be a little careful. What I sometimes do is that I have a dedicated junk email account where I forward emails from my real email account to the junk email accounts, and then IFTTT and Zapier connect to the junk accounts. So I don't care. So they only see what I want them to see, more or less. So if you're concerned about, so these two companies in particular are highly reputable, and I don't think, unless there's a security breach, which can happen, which can even happen directly to your email, unless there's a security breach, I don't think they'll actually do anything nasty with your data. But depending on how paranoid you are about sharing your information, you may want to sort of decide for yourself how you want to set this up. Okay, so one of the things we have, so let's see if, this is, so let me look at my Zaps here. So this is just one of these trigger followed by actions as a concrete example. So this is something I set up a few days ago. It's been working pretty well. So we just saw Airtable, and everybody knows Google Calendar, right? So what we have is that if there is, so remember that Airtable lets you set up multiple views for your data, right? So these were the perspectives that we discussed. So we have set up a view which, this is called the calendar view. I think I showed you the calendar view where things show up in a calendar. So it lets you test and so on. Okay. So this is really the heart of it. It takes the data from Airtable, and you now have access to this data. And now you can put it in Google Calendar, okay? So every time a new record is added to a calendar view or a view that you set up, you say, so what we have is we have a column called calendar, and again, it's a checkbox thing. So some people may announce an event, but they don't want it advertised publicly, in which case we don't check calendar, we don't check public display. But if, assuming that the event is public, then when we enter the record, we will check the calendar option. And then what that'll do is it'll enable that record to show up in the calendar view. And once, because that's how the calendar view is set up, the filter is make sure that calendar column is checked. So once it shows up in the calendar view, that's the trigger for Zapier. So Zapier says, okay, if I see a new entry in this particular view. The reason views are important is because you don't, probably your Airtable or your email has a lot of data coming in. You don't want triggers to be happening on every little thing that happens. So you want triggers to be created only when certain things happen. So this is where views or labels in your email. So do most of you use things like Gmail labels, or you're familiar with Gmail labels? Yes, yeah. So if you use things like Gmail labels, that helps you sort out your email. So you may want to say, so for instance, for my credit card files, this is how it is set up. That if, as I said, it's set up to trigger only when I get an email from my bank, which is where the subject line matches monthly bill or something like that. So the way I figure out if this has happened is because there's a label which is set up using a Gmail filter, and all new emails that match the search get labeled as such. Okay, so most of you probably figured out what's going on here. So again, I don't want to bore you with the details, but the idea is that you can basically, in a fairly friendly way, pull information about what went into Airtable and tell Zapier exactly how I want that information distributed in a Google Calendar event. So I might say, take the date column of Airtable and put it in the date column of Google Calendar, and so on and so forth. Take the title of the event and put it as the title of the event in Google Calendar. Take the description and put it in the description for Google Calendar. So Google Calendar also supports event descriptions, things like that. So mota moti, what's happened at the end of this is that Zapier will check every 15 minutes for new information in your Airtable database. And every time you put in something new, it will get added automatically to your Google Calendar. So you can set it and forget it. I don't need somebody going about adding the talk to the to the Airtable, and then adding it to Google Calendar, and then adding it to some other place. So if I want to maintain like Word files, one for every talk, in some Google Drive folder, then I can set up another thing like this, which says take the data from the Airtable record, create a Word file in this Google Drive folder with the information from the record. And that's it, it's done. You don't have to worry about it after that. In case there is a problem, Zapier will send you an email saying that this trigger failed to work, so please see what's going on. So IFTTT and Zapier really add one new layer of functionality and empowers you to do a lot of automation. And if you just search a little bit on the internet, you'll find a lot of great automation ideas that you can use, and chances are that you'll come up with some yourself, because there are tools that you will use. Of course, I don't know what are the exact tools that you use, but if you search these directories, there's a good chance that some of the things that you use will actually show up here, and you'll find it useful. So for instance, one small way in which I use IFTTT is I often share links to things that I find interesting with my dad and mom, for instance, okay, and some other friends that I have. So whenever I find something interesting, I would typically copy the link, open a new Gmail window, paste the link, and say in the subject, something interesting I found today, and then I would copy all these people and mail them. So now I don't do that. I use a third-party bookmarking service called Pocket. So if you've not heard of Pocket, it's like this nice thing that lets you save articles to look at later. So it's like bookmarks on your web browser, but it's just that it saves the bookmarks to the cloud. So I probably have an embarrassing set of things that I've bookmarked, but okay. So these are a bunch of my bookmarks. You'll see that I use tags. Most of these tags are based on content, but some of these tags are, right, so if I tag something as family, or in fact I have something like to send to family, when I tag something that way, so IFTTT has a rule which says that if a new article is bookmarked to Pocket, which is tagged this way, then take the link and email it to this set of people. So once I tag it, the email is sent. I know it sounds like you're saving 3 seconds or 5 seconds, depending on how quick you are. But the thing is, since this is something I do very frequently, the savings add up over time. That's one thing. The other thing is just like the pleasure of not having to do another mundane thing. So it's just, it just feels good that it's done. So literally, if I went to a website, and so here is a Google extension for Pocket. Right. And I have this tag called Nana, that's what I call my dad in Oriya. So if I tag it this way, he's now going to get a mail in a couple of minutes with a link to this website. I don't know if I want that to happen, but okay. So this is just for demonstration. So this email will get sent once IFTTT has figured out that there is a new link that is tagged this way. So as I say, it's a small thing, but you have like a bunch of these small things that you put into your service, and you might think that it's a lot to remember, but it's really not, because it becomes muscle memory after a while. After you start using these things more and more, it just becomes a part of who you are and what you do. So it kind of helps you. So again, the exact way in which you will do this to save yourself time will depend on how your life is set up and what your workflows are. Okay, let me see if I've got most of this covered. So, right, so I've talked about Zapier and IFTTT and Airtable. So let me just show you my setup for managing my to-do list. Okay, I don't know if I want to necessarily, okay, I'm going to request Devash to cut this out later, because I don't know if I want my to-do list to be on record. But let me just ask this to get a sense. How many of you have like a personal to-do list, or even a team to-do list, where you actually write down and keep track of all the things that you have to get done? Okay, awesome. All right. For everyone else, this is like a really good idea. I mean, I'm biased, obviously. So, but until like maybe 4 or 5 months ago, I would have been in the set of people who wouldn't raise their hand for such a thing, because my first point was the time that I used to create and maintain a to-do list is better spent on actually accomplishing useful tasks. right? So why should I, like, you know, every time I sit down to make a to-do list, it would be a huge burden for two reasons. Pehle to bahut dar lagta hai, it freaks you out. It's like it's such a long list, and writing it down makes it explicit, and you don't want to face this, right? So this is one sort of initial resistance that you have to writing down the things that you have to do. The other thing is, like, ye sab likhne mein aur fir jab khatam kiya to usko scratch karke to keep the to-do list up to date, like, it's such a pain. I'll waste half an hour every day. In that half an hour, I could have, you know, written 5 more emails or done something even more useful than maintaining the to-do list. So that is one. And the other thing is, I was very confident about having a good sense of intuition that, you know, that I have a feel for what is pending, I know what I need to do, so I don't really need a to-do list, right? So for how many of you people is your email your to-do list? You open your email and, you know, all the tasks that you have to do are right there, because, you know, that's how it was for me for a long time, that my email and my, you know, like my sense of people knocking on my door and saying that, you know, you haven't yet done this, send me that, and so on. And people that I would be embarrassed to meet in corridors. that was my sense of these are the things that I have to do. And it was only when I started missing a few appointments and, you know, things started getting seriously overwhelming that I realized that So I think there is this common thing about the brain having a capacity to only keep track of 5 or 6 things at a time and not more than that. So if you try to overwhelm it so much, it first of all leads to a certain kind of stress because you're always worrying. So how many of you have this nagging feeling ki kuch chhoot to nahi gaya, kuch bhool to nahi rahe hain, kahin matlab, you know, is there like a, you know, is there something or the other that I may have forgotten to do, or an email that I forgot to send or whatever. Does anyone feel stressed about, you know, small things like that? Yeah, so, okay, so I'm glad I'm in good company here. So, so the thing is that kind of nagging feeling happens to me all the time. Like there are like 100 different deadlines for 100 different things, many of which come from you people, like, you know, academic offices, pre-registration approve karo, you know, student affairs says ki stock ka abstract bhejo, abhi tak hum announce nahi kar pa rahe hai, and, you know, so all these little things, and I know that each of these things is like 2-2.5 minutes, so it's really amazing that one always fails to get some of these things done, and even when, like, there are other people waiting for you, it feels a little irresponsible when you can't get it done. So obviously I'm probably not the right person to be talking about this because I haven't gotten this down like 100% or anything. I don't always stay on top of things, but relative to the amount of things that need to get done, I think I've started to find a way and feel a sense of, like, you know, at least I have some of my list under control, or at least I know what needs to be done. And the big, okay, so I would argue that the big benefit of having a to-do list is that it gives you more confidence to say no to people. So how many of you have trouble saying no to requests that come up? Mere liye ye kar lo, wo kar lo. And, you know, how many of you feel that it would be impolite or rude to turn people down, so you end up doing it for them, you end up saying yes? Yeah, so difficulty with saying no to people, yes, okay. So some of you, and some of you don't want to admit it. But think about what happens when you don't say no to somebody. Sometimes you end up doing what they want you to do and you do it properly and everything is fine. But a lot of the times what happens is that you don't say no, but you actually cannot handle it. It doesn't fit in your time, you know, your time constraints. And you end up not being able to do it, or you do it really late and it causes stress and friction, and it's an unpleasant situation for everybody involved. Isse acha ki aap pehle se mana kar dete to, you know, banda kisi aur ko dhoond leta or whatever. I mean, you know, and sometimes we have this, okay, some of us at least have this feeling that agar humne nahi kiya, then, you know, the world will come to an end for this person, and, you know, they will not be able to, you know, they've been serious shit. It's usually never like that. I mean, you know, I just try refusing a few requests and observe that people figure things out. I mean, you know, so it's not everyone's hanging on to you completely for dear life. So just, you know, just open up to the, but I have huge trouble saying no, even though sometimes I know that I really cannot manage this. This is not to say that you should always say no, I've become a, you know, person that's just rude all the time. I mean, I think we should, you know, certainly be as helpful as you can be, but if you cannot help, then don't promise to help is what I'm trying to say. So if it's really beyond your schedule, then it doesn't make sense to try and take on something that causes stress to you and to other people. So I used to have difficulty saying no, I still do, but now the thing about writing down my tasks and then actually plotting my tasks to my calendar, so this takes me some time every day, but I do it because then that gives me a very real sense of how full my calendar is. And when I get a random request, I'm able to look at my calendar and say that, okay, I really don't have the time. So even if I wanted to, I couldn't. Or if I really wanted to, then I'd have to knock something off. So that's when you figure out your priorities and you really see if, you know, if this help that you want to, or this commitment, it doesn't always have to be help, but this commitment that you're taking on, is it of a higher priority than something else that you're committed to? So can you knock it off and replace it? Because otherwise, you just cannot do it anyway. You cannot do everything. So it's really important to sort of have a sense of priority and have a sense of, you know, what can you manage when. So I follow what's called, well, I don't strictly follow it. How many of you have heard of GTD, getting things done? Few of you? Okay, so this was like a lot of people consider this to be very, like management speak and marketing and not really very useful. So I agree that it's overrated and it's not as deep as it's made out to be. It's a fairly simple set of principles. But basically, and you can look it up, getting things done, it's sort of, you know, it encourages you to write everything down, all the tasks that you have. And for every task, so there's simple principles like every task should start with a verb so that when you read the task, you're not confused about what to do. You know exactly what to do when you read a task. So even writing down a good to-do list is not, is not always obvious, because if a badly written to-do list can actually make you feel more depressed and worried than not having one at all. So a to-do list is something that should really give you a good sense of direction and, you know, should help you, you know, sort of reclaim your time and reclaim your day. So, I have this empty thing out here. Let me just see if... Okay, so for me, every task gets associated with a bunch of attributes, including things like a time estimate, a status, a context, and a time when I'm comfortable doing it. So time estimate, it's really hard to come up with good time estimates. You always say, 2 minutes mein ho jayega, and then, you know, for half an hour, you're still struggling with whatever it is, right? Or you say, so every day in the morning, I tell my mom that I'll wake up in 5 minutes, and it's never happened so far. So you're really bad at making time estimates. So that's one thing that you learn after observing yourself for many weeks or months, is to, you know, you start making more realistic time estimates. But yeah, for me, it's divided into something that's like super quick, something that's short. Short is 15 to 30 minutes, long is 1 to 1.5 hours, and intense is something that really needs, you know, like I need to sit down for a very long time to do it. If I'm reading a paper or something like that, or setting up a quiz, then that's an example of intense. The status goes between, this we spoke about a little bit, whether it's on me, whether I have to give it to somebody, whether I'm waiting for somebody, or passing the buck is like, it's still on me, but I can take care of it by giving it to somebody. So, you know, whether it's a TA or a friend or whatever. So, of course, one status that I haven't put here, maybe because it doesn't happen that often, is done, that the task is done, and I don't have to worry about it anymore, okay? But those are tasks that I just delete from my system, so I don't worry about it. But some people like to keep them to get a sense of accomplishment. So context is going to be different for different people, but I have, like, you know, for my tasks, I know what kind of work they involve. So this is just, you know, what type of a task is it? And as I said, what time of the day? So my routine is divided up into 3 or 4 slots. So like 3 or 4 slots in the day when I work, and I usually know my energy level. So I know that after lunch, when I'm sleepy and bored, is the best time to do emails and things like that. So I have a sense of at what time, what things I like to do. So the good thing about setting all this up is that now you can use Airtable's filters when you sit down, to figure out what is your list of. Some people like to have priorities. I don't like, I mean, you know, I don't put it down explicitly. I use my intuition. You could also put priorities. But the really cool thing is start date. Start date is, this is the day that I'm going to start the task. So the nice thing is that when you do this for the first time, you can project tasks into the future and you can sort of not have to worry about it. So what I would do is I would have a filter which says, show me only those tasks where the start date is on or before today. Right? So this is very easy to do. This is like plain English, where start date is on or before today. So if a task is set to start later, so file your income tax returns, starts, you know, June 2018. So the thing is that once I put these things down, I know that these important things, like, you know, call the AC service person or whatever. So these could be personal tasks, it could be tasks that your team is engaged in, it could be anything. But the recurring ones, that the ones that leave you with this nagging feeling ki hum kuch bhool to nahi rahe hai or whatever, so try to sit down and really collect all of them and based on your past experiences and put it down. If something occurs to you that you don't have to do now but you have to do at a future date, just put it down in your management system, and using this filter you never see them. So you never see them until you actually have to do them. So it doesn't overwhelm you, it doesn't clutter your mind, but you still feel a little liberated because you know that the things that you have to do, you made a note of it and it'll kind of pop up. So if you're fancy with Zapier and things like that, you can even send emails to yourself at you know, appropriate intervals reminding you. So if you live in your email and you use your email to get reminded about things, then you could do that. I personally like to keep my email as clutter-free as possible, so I don't, but I live in my task management system. I check it all the time. So that's what I would use instead. So my Airtable is empty because for this particular thing I don't use Airtable. I use a different piece of software, but you could very well use Airtable for something like this. It helps you kind of really just streamline the things that you have to do. And the nice thing about Airtable is that you can share, just like Google Sheets, you can share a particular table or a particular set of tables with your friends, with your coworkers, with your family, etc. So if you are working in a team, you know, in the same space, and you have a collective things of, you know, list of things that you have to do, you could just add a column here saying person or something like that, and then, you know, so then you can say that this is now in this person's court and this person is looking after it, and so on and so forth. And you also have to agree to not be mischievous about changing that column. So, you know, everybody has to have a shared understanding of what it means to use a tool like this. But what this can do for you is, I mean, you don't have to, so if the system feels like too much, as I said, I had a lot of resistance because I was like, kaun itna sab karega? I know what I have to do for the day. I will ride my sense of intuition. Which, if that's working for you, then that's awesome. I mean, everybody obviously has their own styles. This is a very personal thing. But for me, as I said, the main relief was the confidence with which I could tell people that, no, now my calendar is full and I cannot teach another course next semester, or I cannot, because the moment I'm teaching a course now, I have recurring tasks that, you know, take up, you know, 3 hours a day, 2 days a week, just to prepare for the classes, because I know I will need that much time. So that gets blocked off in my calendar now. And now the more full my calendar gets, the more evidence I have that I really am getting to the point where I cannot squeeze in another new project or another new whatever. So I've just found this useful, if nothing else, for having evidence. But I also do check the list, like every day in the morning I check the list, I transfer. So hopefully you have a small number of things that you have to do every day. I transfer it to a piece of paper, and that does guide me through my day a little bit more now, a little more than before. But obviously, I mean, this is neither necessary nor sufficient. So I have these systems, I'm as messed up as ever, so that can happen. There are people who don't have systems but somehow just manage everything amazingly well. And the people, you know, so they're all combinations. So as long as you're going with your intuition and you're comfortable with what you're doing, it's great. But I'm hoping that some of these ideas will hopefully be helpful, supplements to whatever workflows and systems you already have. So with that, I'm hoping that we can open this up to a more, informal chat. I think I managed to bore all of you for quite a while now, so I think I will sort of conclude here, and I'm happy to take questions if there are any. But